So you want to solve the topological string on a compact Calabi-Yau, and so I will address a couple of questions which are different and to the local case and so on. So we want to solve the topological string on compact Calabi-Yau threefold, and I will call this M. And what I mean by that, so it's now maybe more specific, is the a string partition function, so it's the closed string partition function. So this will depend on certain Kähler parameters, and it will depend on the string coupling. And we all know it's a sort of perturbative expansion. And then there will be a class kappa, let's say an H2MZ. And there will be a sum over the genus, G equals 0 to infinity. And then there are, so this is a generating function, like 2G, so this is GS, 2G minus 2. And then there are numbers that we want to know. So let's say R. So they are labeled by this class kappa. Let's put it up. And then G. And then there is a parameter which counts, let's call this Q kappa. So this counts the class kappa. So it's a generating function basically for all these numbers. And these numbers are Gromov-Witten invariants, and we would like to know them. And the T, this T parameter is hidden here. So T is something like the volume of a curve. So you have B field, and you have, so it's somehow the complex volume of the volume of the curve complexified with the B field, and you write it in this combination, and then the Q kappa is something like E to the T kappa, and so in this way you get the scalar volumes in. So these are the scalar parameter. Now, in some sense, this is a perturbative expansion. You have to think whether it makes sense or whether there are better forms of it and so on. But what I can give you today is basically is an attempt to give you this function for elliptically fibered Calabi-Yau in a more or less closed form, in that I expand in the base of the elliptic fibration. So for every fixed class in the base, I give you a closed form. And so that's the aim of the talk. So, of course, there's a certain motivation. So, of course, I said already, this solves Gromov-Witten theory, solves GV theory, or at least the counting problem of it. And it would also solve, this was already in Martin's talks, it solves maybe DT on PT theory, because these invariants are related. And then what is more interesting for me, and where I get some structure out, it also solves a BPS counting problem in five dimensions, in 5D. And this BPS counting problem basically is you look at the 5D Poincaré group, and then you see that there is the little group of the 5D Lorentz group, so there's the little group, and this is SU2 left times SU2 right. And now there is certainly a mass to get this Poincaré representation. There's a mass, and you sort of want to calculate something which depends here on the right spin and the left spin and the mass. And so what you want to do, you want to take a trace of the Hilbert space of these BPS states. And then you have various choices. So for instance, first I will sort of don't resolve the right spin. So I write something like just JR like this. And then you write a parameter for the left spin. and then you write something which measures the, measures the energy. But since they are BPS states, this energy is fixed by a charge lattice, and this charge lattice turns out to be this cohomology lattice. So then this is where the kappa class comes in. And so at the end, you get something which you can write, and this was done by Gopa Kumar and Wafa. You can write it, well, also by Nekrasov independently somehow. And so you can write it as a sum over, let's say, the genus, which is positive. And then there is an E kappa G. And then this parameter Y appears here. So it's something like something that we also saw in Martin's talk already. And then it's a 2G, and then you have this E to the T kappa that measures, is basically this Q. So this measures the mass, and then they are fixed by this kappa class, and this kappa lies in the lattice, and this is because they are BPS states. But then there is actually a very interesting formula that is implied by that, which I'm really use in the following, and that formula, I mean, again, it goes back to Narayan, Taylor, and then was made more general by Gopa Kumar and Wafa. So this formula looks like this. It basically involves these quantities here. So these are BPS indices, and they can be in Z. So note that if you sort of resolve this right spin, so maybe resolve J right, and then you get this this minus one gets a U, and then you get on the right hand side things which depend on J left and J right, and not just on the genus, and on kappa, and these are actually in N, and that's sometimes interesting. So this is more like a real counting problem. This is like an index counting problem, and for you can actually do both in the cases that I will discuss. I only restrict myself to the index counting problem because the formulas are simpler, but you can certainly do both with a very similar formalism that you will see. So so then you get here, well, m from 1 to infinity, and then you get a sum over g from 0 to infinity, and then you get a sum over this kappa that we already had. And then you get this I G kappa, and then you get G S M over 2, and then 2 G minus 2, and then you get again this E to the M T kappa. Okay, so this formula is sort of slightly bizarre. And it has been used, the fact that it's slightly bizarre, because if it is a perturbative expansion, then at all rational numbers of GS, it has actually poles. That's pretty bizarre. So so let me say, note the poles. So these come from genus 0, because then this is minus 1. And so note the poles at, so these poles, of course, will play a role. So if they are rational, then you get the poles. And that's already, I mean, this is one of the starting point of this non-perturbative completion that Marcus and his friends are studying. So that is also true for the compact case and for the non-compact case. But now let me say generally that, so let me not erase this formula for a second. So so I erased already a formula which maybe you would have protested. So why should you have protested? So let me write this formula again. So let's write it like GS2G minus, and then write just FT like this. So this is better for this purpose. And you see, these things are Kähler line bundle. So they live in the Kähler line bundle. I mean, this comes from special geometry, like we heard in the talk of Belavin. So this is like a section of L2G minus 2. So then if you think this is a good object, you have a problem, because this comes in all powers of the exponential. If you make a Kähler transformation, you get a problem. And I will come to this point later, but you can remedify this. You can say, okay, I take GS and I take a period of that. Now the period works, the period transforms in the inverse line bundle. So then this formula certainly makes sense. But then it's not anymore, has any good modular properties, because the period is some complicated object that transforms very complicated under monodromy. And in some sense, the reason that in the local case you have this is one, you have a global section here, makes this formula work. If you apply it, I mean, for instance, this wave function thing in the local case, this has beautiful application. But in the global case, this thing is very much spoiled, this property. So so this would be only in the local case. And this is a huge difference for the global case. But let me now come to the geometries that I want to consider. And these geometries have very much to do with the talk that you heard by Martin Kohl. Except that I'm not looking at elliptic surfaces, but I'm looking at elliptic threefolds. So let me sort of make this small remark. So basically, local Calabiau, they are always, so to say, of the type you take a total space. So M, what is my Calabiau, is basically the total space of the anticanonical line bundle over some base. So what I want to do is, and then this can be solved in many ways. So what I want to do today is basically to change the setting slightly, but not so much. So we make a Calabiau threefold, which is compact. So this is clearly non-compact because you have this non-compact line bundle. But the only thing that I want to do is I want to exchange this compact, non-compact line bundle by an elliptic fiber. So then you have this situation, and M is compact. And that is not at all very outlandish when you look at the history of Calabiau. So for instance, if you take the degree 18 constraint in, let's say, 9 weighted projective space.
So unfortunately,
because of that scheme, we cannot get anything which is low. Aha, so maybe we should just put it down. Okay, so then you have this Calabiau, so this is one of the earliest things, it's a degree 18 hypersurface in this projective space, weighted projective space, so it's 6, 9, 6, 1, 1. And now if you write this down, you can immediately see that you get an equation which has this elliptic structure, because you call this coordinate y, you call this coordinate x, and this coordinate you call u, and then of course it's already an elliptic curve. So it goes y squared, and then you have, I don't know, I don't care about the coefficient at the moment, you have x to the 3 because it's degree 18, and then you get something like a x, y, z, and then you have a product of these u's. Let me call them u prime for the second. And then you get a z to the 6. So the z to the 6 you don't see there because this has a singularity. You need a blow-up parameter, and this is the z to the 6. And then we have a b phi I from 1 to r u I 6. And then you get a polynomial pb u of m. And this I write down because now you can see. So this is the constraint. So this is basically the constraint for this particular Calabiau. But you can replace this base. So if this, in this case, the base is actually P2. But you can certainly do this for any base. So that's is very simple. Yeah, so this guy has exactly the same situation in Martin Kohl's talk. It has at codimension 1, has only Codira fibers E1. And then at higher codimension, there are more singular fibers. But the important point that in codimension 1 is only E1 Codira fibers. And then you can calculate the discriminant. It has some cusps and so on. So it's a complicated thing. But I will basically make a prediction for the Gromov-Witten theory on this space, which I think Martin also tried to solve. It's not so easy. And then he resorted to the surfaces again. And okay, anyway, so so then, but I want to give you this algebraic form. This is basically like a B model expression to see how it connects to the local case. Because if you take this PB, 0, and you this depends on U and M, and you set it to 0, well, it's actually like UV. This is actually the mirror curve. So it sort of has a, so this is the mirror curve, and it's a spectral curve of a matrix model, and it has many, many nice properties. And you can also see how you achieve this. So basically, you say XE. This is the class of the fiber. So you take it b to the a to the 6. So the a is this. The b is this. And then you you send this to 0. But you keep somehow b fixed. And then you get this. So I should say this. Depends on B, and then it, well, I mean, this is this M are mass parameters, but then it also depends on U, and the U are basically the same U, only you have an etal map between them. So basically there's a U is U to the 1/6, so this is an etal map. So that's the way you get this local geometries. But now let me change gears a little bit and say the same thing from the point of view of the A model. So for the A model, of course, I've given you the geometry. It's basically it's an elliptic vibration over B, and then you can use Serre's spectral sequence in order to get all the topology from the base if the fibers are not so singular. So the question was already asked. So today. Similar like in the talk of Martin, we have one section and only Kodaira I1 fibers in CODIM 1. And then everything is actually given by this spectral sequence. So now we use Larrey's spectral sequence to get the topological data, the topology of M just from B. So that's easy exercises, and it works very nicely. So so let me introduce some notation. So it doesn't pay to keep this formula, but so so basically now we introduce some classes. So we introduce the class of the fiber, which I call T, and I call this exponential thing Q, and then so this is the now we go to the homology. So what do we have? So we have we have a curve class. I call this curve class E for elliptic fiber. So this is the class of the fiber. And if you want to calculate the scalar parameter, you just take what I said before, the B and the omega, the symplectic form, and integrate it over this curve class. So this is this volume. And then you have dual divisors. And these dual divisors, I also need name for them. And then you have the class beta. These are classes in the base. So these are in H2BZ. And then I have, here I have, well, the dual divisors go a little bit higher. So here the dual divisors, I should already have a DE. And I put a tilde here. So this is actually the class of E, which is the class of the section, and then it's shifted by the canonical class of the basis. So this is just follows from the geometry of this. And here I have classes which I call DK. So maybe I call this also K. So there might be K of them. And that is just the, so here we have, of course, E So we have a projection map from E to B, where the fiber is here, and then this I call P, and then this one are, so to say, pull back from the base. So this is DK, and these are living on the base. So these are these classes, and now you can calculate all the intersection numbers just based on these classes and the intersection numbers of the base. So that's an easy thing, but I need it for some later work. So let me just say that, okay, so you now calculate dE squared. So this was this class here. And this one just gives the integration of the second Chern class. So if I say C, that CK is always the Chern class of the base. And if it's not the Chern class of the base, I write the manifold. Okay, so this is the Chern class of the base. And then we have let's say dE times dE. So this is now intersected with this base classes once, and this is the C1 of the base times dK. So this dK is this guy. So this is a divisor on the base, and this number I will call 12 AK. So this is the definition of what AK is, and then you have intersection of dE, dJ, dK, and these ones are just given by intersection of the base. So this is intersection of the base. So this is just over the base, and you take the dJ, dI, and you integrate it over the base. So this gives all the intersection numbers, and the one which is three times things of the base is, of course, zero, because it's a vibration. Okay, so then you can get more. So you can basically get a C2 of M. So now this is in the total space times dE. And you calculate it, and it's... so this is like a Hirzebruch-Riemann-Roch formula, and it's like this. And you can also calculate this one on these other types of divisors. And it gives 12 AK. This is what I introduced as AK. And then the Euler number is actually minus 60 times C1 squared of the base. So for instance, in this case, this is this famous Euler number, 450. Minus 450 is the second example that Candelas ever looked at. This is this case. Okay, so then to exhibit the modularity, I have to make a little change in the... So this is the basis of the classes and the curves for the Mori cone. So this was the Mori cone. And I make a little change from that and define dE. So this was also why they are tilted before. dE, I shift again with this canonical pullback of the canonical class of the base. And then that will lead to... So if the QK were e to the 2 pi I TK, and this shifts these classes of the base by, so they were before TK, and now they are get shifted like this, with tau. And then why do I make this change of the base? I basically make this change of the base because I didn't like this coupling. So I like this coupling, I don't like this coupling, sort of, which mixes the fiber and the base in a way that I don't like. So basically now in this new base, so the key property is that in the new base, so if I use these guys, then these guys are actually zero. And by the way, these DKs don't change, so they are just the same. Okay, so now I can start stating the main theorem, and then I try to prove the theorem. And this has very nice, so to say, insight in the wave function transformation of the compact topological string, and I also need this formula. So let me make the claim. So what is the claim? So now, so we of course, our goal is to expand the string partition function, and now expand it in a particular way. So you have the fiber class, you have these base classes that are defined, and you have the string coupling. And now you decide, so to say, to expand it in terms of the base classes, as I said. So, and you pull out beta equals zero, which is special. It's not Jacobi form, but the other will be Jacobi form. That's why you pull it out. And then you have the rest is a very systematic expansion. So it's a B in HMZ, and then it's a Z B tau GS, and then it's QB. So, and basically the whole thing that I want to explain to you today is why are these guys Jacobi forms? And how you can calculate them, and how you can eventually solve the problem. So that's the point. So these guys are the main characters in the rest of the talk. So what are the properties? So I give you a list of properties of this ZB TGS. And so let's start with property one. So they have basically three properties. And I'm able to prove some of these properties. So let's start with property one. So what is this? So the ZB, tau GS, are Jacobi forms. In fact, they are meromorphic Jacobi forms, not weak. So these guys have poles, which the poles come basically from here. So they are meromorphic Jacobi forms, and these meromorphic Jacobi forms, they have a weight, and they have an index, and the weight of this guy I call in general K, and is zero. That's very good. And the index is actually, I call it M, and it depends on the base class, of course, and it's 1/2 times the class B times B minus the canonical class, so 1CB. And if you know a little bit of algebraic geometry, it's basically the genus of the curve in the base minus 1. So that's the index. And then this is not completely true. It's up to a multiplier system, which is, however, very trivial. So the multiplier system comes because this quantity is not completely SL2Z invariant. So the multiplier system comes because if you make the S transformation on this Q beta, then you will find that this is actually depends on the parity of this curve. So basically it is minus 1 to the C1 times beta times Q beta. And if you make the T transformation on it, then it has a similar factor. So it's minus 1 C1B times Q beta. So this is a multiplier system, which so the ZBs have to spill out these factors to make this expression invariant. Okay, so then the poles are, yeah, I will talk about the poles, but the poles are basically imposed from that. So they are basically over Q, and that means they are the torsion point of the elliptic argument. So one of the most important thing, of course, which physically is that you basically identify G with Z, which is the elliptic argument of the weak Jacobi form. That's the most important point in this. So I don't know how much I should say about Jacobi forms. So it's a pleasure to talk about them, but many people know them, or many people don't get too much out of it. But let me say one very trivial thing. So Jacobi forms. So basically, what is it? It's a map from the upper half plane times C into C. And well, that's here in the upper half plane lives what we call the elliptic argument, the modular argument. So it's the modular argument. And here lives what we call the elliptic argument. And this is the one which is going to identify it with the string coupling. And so they can be holomorphic, meromorphic, whatever. And now they have, of course, transformation properties. So you say gamma is a matrix A, B, C, D in SL2Z. And then you can make the following. You have the following transformation properties. So basically, that's the defining transformation properties, modularity and modularity and and quasi-periodicity. And the modularity says, okay, the modularity says that if you say this is this normal transformation, CT plus D, so it's the projective transformation, and it says that if you now plug in here and you take the T of gamma, and then there's also a Z of gamma, which is just Z of C tau plus D, and you put here the Z of gamma, then this thing is basically invariant up to a phase, and this phase is related to the index of this guy. So that is the M. So it's related to the index, and then it is M, and then the C comes up. This is the C really from here, and then it's C squared, and then it's over C tau plus D. And then, as I said, it's invariant otherwise. So it's just the phase. And then the so this is the modularity. And the quasi-periodicity says if it's so to say a model, it gives a reason to call this the elliptic argument, because elliptic curve, of course, you can shift by one and you can shift by tau and it should not be invariant, again up to a phase. So that makes this an elliptic argument. So if you take C plus mu plus lambda tau, then again it's basically the same up to a phase. So it's e to the minus 2 pi m, and then lambda tau plus 2 lambda z. And by the way, here I forgot something important, which nobody seemed to have realized. So here is a factor of ct plus d to the k. And that gives the weight, and that is the other thing that comes in. OK, the index comes in here. So the index is only coming as a phase. Okay, and then of course I should say that you know Jacobi forms anyway. So many things are the Weier transform is a Jacobi form. The theta functions are Jacobi forms with vector value Jacobi forms. They are Jacobi forms. So there are lots of Jacobi forms that you know. But the
can you restrict Jacobi forms to classical modular forms?
The Jacobi forms have an expansion. If you expand them in Z, then you get the quasi-modular forms. You get the Eisenstein series E2, E4, E6, and so on. So I guess that's all what I want to say about Jacobi forms. But now, well, at least at the general Jacobi forms. So now let me sort of come to the property 2. So the property 2 is the following. The property 2 is that the set B are not arbitrary Jacobi forms, but they are Jacobi forms of a very particular type. They have the Dedekind adder function raised to 12 times C1 times B. And then they have a numerator, phi B, tau of z, and this one is a weak Jacobi form. So this is a very strong statement, as it turns out, Jacobi form, and this also is sort of in the title then, finally. And then the denominator is something which goes from L to 1 to B2, so this is the numbers of the classes in the base, and then it's an S from 1 to BL. So BL is the lth component of this vector B that gives the class of the base. And then we have tau SZ. So I haven't told you what this guy is. But in order to tell you this, I have to go say a little bit more about the structural theorem of Jacobi forms. So there is a very important theorem of Eichler and Sergey. So this theorem says, basically, the weak Jacobi forms are finitely generated and freely from by the Eisenstein series E4, the Eisensteins, and I call this actually Q, and then E6, and then two other arguments. So these arguments have just weight, no index. And then there are things which have index, and that is sometimes called gamma minus phi 1. So this is the notation. This is K and this is M here. This is always like this, K and M. So this has K minus 1 and index M. and then it's the, and I said you know Jacobi forms. You, of course, the Jacobi, the theta functions, they have a multiplier system. But there's one theta function which goes into itself, and that's theta 1. And so this can be used to build a Jacobi form. And you have to square it, and then you take eta to the 6. And you see this has, so to say, weight. This has weight 1. This has weight 3. Then you have minus 2. And then to the question that was already asked, you can sort of have two interesting expansions. So let me write this like this. X1, so there's a product expansion, which is sort of nice and useful, actually. So this, of course, just comes from the Jacobi triple product identity and is given like this. And now to this other question. So you can write this in terms of expansion in Z, and then this expansion coefficients will be actually out of the ring of quasi-modular form. So this is spanned by E2, E4, and E6. So here is like this, and then it goes with order Z squared. I'm off in the order. So this is just Z to the 4, and so it's only even. So for instance, if you want to do open strings, of course you naively would say you have to do odd Jacobi forms. They're even Jacobi forms, they're odd Jacobi forms. But you certainly get here only powers which are even in Z. And that means even in GL. Anyway, so this is the story. And now you see why I picked this denominator, and that's why I left this formula. Basically, this denominator is precisely to reproduce this poles at the torsion point. Because you see, this square goes with GS, with Z. So it has poles. And I multiply here by S to get in this multi-covering that generates these torsion points at the rational. I put here this power of this A. So it's basically to reproduce this torsion points. And this is, this is another generator. So there's another generator. So the other generator is called B, and it has weight 0 and index 1. So B, people write like 0, 1. And this is, well, maybe I just be brief and don't, well. So it's 1/2 of the elliptic genus of K3 that I suppose everybody knows. That is actually, so you take K 1, 2, 3, 4. And then you take a ratio of theta functions. So this is theta at the argument tau and z equals 0. That's why you don't take the 1. And then, so it's anyway has weight 0 because you have this nice ratio. And then the weight comes from this theta. So this is k t. And then here is the full argument. and you square both of them, and that's the elliptic. So these are the other Jacobi tether functions. So this is generated by these things, and and this is already extremely powerful. The statement, in the sense that, so let's go back to B is equal to P2. Well, now I tell you for degree zero, all fiber degrees. The only thing is that I have to fix a ring whose dimension you can easily determine, because I have told you the dimension of this Z, the index and the weight of that. Don Sagi has given you the index and the weight of this, and of course this is classic. And so then I just can build an object which has the right index and the right and the weight, and it will be, let's say, Z1. Well, let me just suggest Z1 is, as I said, phi 1 over eta to the 18, and then it will be just a tau z, and this is the only thing that I need to give you, and this this one is very primitive, so it's minus q over 48, and then 31 q cubed, and then 113 p. So this has a weight 12, 16. No index in this case, because the formulas work out. And this gives already infinite number of predictions for a higher genus. And so you can iterate this process. And then since the ring is not so small, at some point you would still run out of boundary conditions. But for instance, it's easy to do it for B equals 6 in this case. That's OK. So you get a lot of predictions. And I can sort of convert them in BPS invariants, give you integer numbers, and sort of these were the things that well, you can also write it as Donaldson-Thomas invariants and so on. So let me come to the property 3. So the property 3 is also very nice. So the property 3 says that once the index is negative or smaller than, actually smaller equal than 0, so there's a property 3, property 3, and the claim is if MB is smaller equal 0, then the phi beta are completely fixed. Fixed by the vanishing, by the known vanishing IG beta. So these are the BPS indices. And basically, you know that that if G is greater, so this happens if G is basically too great, is too big. So this happens if there's a little bit of dependence on the base, but it basically goes with the base degree. So if B is bigger than this number, then this thing will be zero. And you can show that if the index is negative, then this grows very small, this room of weak Jacobi forms. And then this this conditions solves it completely. So this particular solves the M string, the E string, the refined M string, the refined E string, things which have singular fibers, and so on. So this observation, because all these things, precisely the things that Soto and these people classified, they were rigid in the base. So they rely on a negative self-intersection curve. Then this is negative, the index, because of the formula I gave you. And then you can solve it. So this solves a lot of theories. But these are local theories. So this is not, so it's the old thing. For some reason, the global theories are really, really much harder. But they are more non-trivial than the usual local theories that we look at, for a reason that I now explain. So let me sort of, in the last minutes, try to say you some interesting aspects of the proof of it. Yes? Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So they are not doing this very good. But that's why we now work with them. Okay. Anyway. So let me say some interesting aspects of the proof. So, property one is certainly the most important one. So let me try to make you understand property one, because it's very simple. So property one. So you know that this, first you have to establish modularity. But I don't want to go into the details. Basically, there's a formalism which is comes from the derived categories. So basically, in this case, there's a Fourier-Mukai kernel. So in homological mirror symmetry, if you have an elliptic vibration, you have a certain property of the Fourier-Mukai kernel. So basically, what people always, well, let me just sort of draw you one diagram so that you get that. If you want to look it up, you can see it. So there's two projections. You take M times M, and you take two projections to the base. And then there is this Fourier-Mukai kernel. This is the only thing that you have to know. So this is theta. So this is the discriminant. And then it's E times M minus M times E. And then you subtract only also C1 of the base. And then when you have this object, then you can say that in the, so this is basically homological mirror symmetry, then you have your the A brains, but and then you know that the S transformation on F, on anything in F in the A brains, can be written out in terms of this Fourier-Mukai kernel. So that's, so you take some pullback of this, and then you take some left action on this map, and then you take F, and you take this this Fourier-Mukai kernel. Sorry, this I should write it like this, and then you you have P, and for some reason we also tensor it also, always with. So this has to do with my shift of bases. So the upshot is, when you have this formula and you know these classes, then you can write down an S transformation matrix entirely in terms of the intersection of this thing. This works basically for fourfolds, threefolds, K3, whatever. So everything that has mirror symmetry. So basically, then the S matrix, I just give you the S matrix. So the S matrix will be something like 1 minus 1. And then 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So this is basically the S. This is the block which is the S. And then the other thing, so to say, here is a block which has AK. And then there is a block which has CK, J. So basically, I write this like X naught, XK, F naught. I introduce also a T, XT. And then I have F naught, FT, and FK. So this is basically is the zeros period. Then this is the one which talks to the tau. This is the one which talks to the base classes. And these are the dual periods in the same. And it's a bit ugly. So XK. So this, writing a matrix. So then this one is AK, as I said, and then it has here 0, 0, and then it has this intersection matrix on the base, IK, and then it's minus 1 and 0, 0, 0, 0, and it has AJ, and then it's A, that is A, no, 0, then it's C1 squared, and 0, 0, 0, and then minus AJ. And so there's all the intersection numbers. So the point is, you can establish, and you can also do this by just looking at the analytic continuation of the periods. This is just a homological mirror symmetry argument. If you are powerful and want to analyze a system of, let's say, where you have 10 moduli, 2 from the fiber, 8 from 9 from the base, then you could also do this by analytic continuation. But the mathematicians give you a very nice answer, and this answer is basically due to Bridgeland. He does this for K3s, and then other people like Yao and company have done it for higher dimensional cases. And we can, I mean, they did it sort of wrong, so then we had to do it again. But it's anyway standard. And then there's the S transformation. The S transformation is even simpler. So the T transformation. The T transformation, you just tensor by, you just tensor F naught just by this line bundle. So then, so T would be T of F naught. You just tensor this by a certain line bundle, and that's what we know as the B field shift. So that's, and again, we do a little bit shift by this class. So anyway, and this matrix will be look similar. All in the intersection numbers. The only thing that now you have (1, 1, 0, 1). And then other classical intersection numbers. So why I'm saying this? So I'm saying this because to show you that if you have a partition function and you have this symmetry, then you would expect it to be modular. Because after all, these are the space-time generators of the space-time duality. And if you have an object on the Calabi-Yau, it should better be modular. I mean, this is what string theory tells you. And now I want to make the one important point before I finish. So the one important point is, so if you look at Witten's wave function transformation property, I already alluded to this a little bit. Then, so you have, so Witten says, okay, we have this e to the g equals 0 to infinity, and then we have this, what I wrote already before. The only difference is he now calls this the wave function. And then he goes into geometric quantization of H2R. So then you do geometric quantization. Of H3MR. And you want that this, so to say, doesn't depend on the polarization. And since the polarization is given by the change of the complex structure, you get a differential equation in this complex structure. And this is, looks like a heat equation. And it looks like this. There's a, so it's because, so let me say a couple of things. So basically, he sets this like this, h bar. And then he has an h bar squared. And then he has an alpha, beta, gamma. So this is originally how he writes it, beta. So this is a bar index, and this is a gamma. And then this guy annihilates this wave function. So this is the infinitesimal statement for the fact that this wave function should not depend on the polarization. And since the polarization is induced on which complex structure you use, there is a differential with respect to this complex structure. This is a complex structure variable. Okay, and then you see, and many people have looked at this, including BCOV, and you say this cannot be right. Well, it cannot be right for two reasons, and let me sort of give you the trivial reason. So first of all, it is right, but people thought it was not right, and I should tell you why it is right after all. So basically, let me give you first make a small remark. So I said already that this is bizarre because here you have no invariance, right? You shouldn't take this. Rather, you should take x naught, some period. You can take any period. But this period should be so that it cancels the Kähler transformation. Otherwise, this object makes no sense in the beginning. I mean, because it's not invariant on the Kähler transformation. So, and if you do that and you look at this transformation, you will see that x naught actually goes under ST transformation, because this is x naught. It goes to x naught C tau plus D. So if this goes, transforms like this, then these guys have to compensate that. And if they compensate that, then these guys must be modular forms of a certain weight. So it follows that the fg are as a function of tau, so this holds all in the limit of the base expansion, are are forms, modular forms of a certain weight. Of a weight. And the weight you can, it's just, the weight is just given by this index 2d minus 2. And now comes the second thing that is very important. But now this guy is almost quasi-periodic because of the Gopa-Kumar-Wafa formula. So you know already that Z goes to Z plus 1 is actually an OK transformation. Of this is because of the BPS formula. So if this is a correct transformation and you have this property, you can see easily that you also have to shift by tau. That's trivial. You just write it down, this expansion, you shift this by this amount, and then you use that as invariant, and you have to see that this is actually not just a shift, but it has to also be shifted by tau, must be also possible. So this implies quasi-periodicity. So this is very trivial in some sense. So, but you have to see the following. I mean, you don't really change the polarization because you just rotate the A matrices. Changing the polarization means changing the B periods and the A periods. You don't do this. So if you would change the B periods, then you would actually change the polarization, and the whole thing becomes very intriguing. So then it's not so easy to say what is the invariance of it. But here we got lucky because we have this monodromies which just change, so to say, the A periods, not the B periods. So the full power of this whole thing that I may be saying would be for the quintic when you have this transformation, but you also change the polarization. Then it will be very, very powerful, even for this case, I believe. And then there was a second point that I should really finish quickly. As I said, I mean, this quantity, look at this at g equals 0. So in at the lowest order in h. So in lowest order of h bar, this thing is simply wrong. Because if you pull this down, then you get something. So now I sort of absorb this. I mean, I sort of introduce a new parameter like this. Well, this is the h. So it's just a power counting parameter. So now I take the derivative of respect b with h and look in the lowest order in h bar. Then, of course, this gives an anti-holomorphic derivative of f naught, which is the prepotential, and it gives something here from which is not vanishing, because this one is a holomorphic derivative. So then everybody says, I mean, like Berschatsky and Digraph and people who talked about the OSV conjecture, they all say, forget about the genus zero part. This thing has to be modified. And they modify it simply by excluding all the consequences of it at genus 0 and genus 1, actually. Genus 1 is also a problem. So precisely the cases where you have this killing field on the world sheet are a problem. So I'm saying this is not what you should do. So what you actually should do, there is a, even in the old literature on special geometry by Strominger, there is an unholomorphic prepotential. And this has very much to do also with the talk of Bellarmine. So there is an unholomorphic prepotential. And this unholomorphic prepotential has the property that the triple couplings are not given by this, but they are given by the covariant derivative of that. So it's the covariant derivative, let's call this unholomorphic prepotential S. And you see, since this contained, this one is more trivial, but they start containing the Christoffel symbols of the connection, so they are not holomorphic. So if this is going to be holomorphic, which of course is true in conformal field theory, because you fix 3 points on the sphere, there's no degeneration, that is holomorphic. But this one will be not holomorphic. I mean, this would not work if this is holomorphic. So take this non-holomorphic. So the point that I'm making is, this thing works if you take this old definition of Strominger for the non-holomorphic prepotential. But then you can ask, do you know that object? And it turns out you know it. It is precisely the propagator of BCOV. So, Well, there in BCOV series are propagators, and what I call S is actually S, so that's why I call it propagator. So I take the bar of the propagator of BCOV, and then I take a factor of the Kähler factor to give it the right Kähler weight. So this is the Kähler factor. So this had for instance -2, and then I wanted to have. I know it has 2, so I wanted to have it -2, 1, and this has clearly 2, 2, this factor. So there I make it to the right weight, and this thing is actually fulfills it. And now you can think, what is then this equation? Is it really fulfilled or not, if you take a different definition? And it turns out it's fulfilled, and it's very beautiful. It's basically fulfilled by this Ramanujan identity for modular form. So you take, well, I mean, it's so to say convenient to write this as a matrix of propagators, which is, you change the coordinate, but it's basically 2S, SI, SI. So there are 3 types of propagators in BCOV, and so this is a change of matrix, and then you have immediately a property of this big propagators, which actually we have found in the paper with Marcos and Grimm and some people in Malin, Weiss, I guess. And this is like CKM, N, and then it's the propagator again, MI, propagator NJ. And you see, this is precisely, when you complex conjugate, this is precisely what you need. It's precisely, if you take this S as the propagator, you precisely fulfill this equation. And why I'm saying this? I'm saying this because from this equation, if it's correct, then you can get also the index. So you just calculate it and use the properties of this in terms of the topological numbers, and then you get the index. So the other properties, I mean, the property 3 is easy to establish. The property 2 is not so easy to establish, also part of the thing that the paper is not out. And maybe I should finish.